Hey, Gleb Alexandrov here for CreativeShrimp.com. After watching this video, you'll learn to take your 3D lighting skills to the next level by using reverse key lighting. This technique is so easy to implement and so elegant that once I discovered it, I use it all the time. I think you should definitely add this lighting technique to your books alongside other techniques that we talk about in our cinematic lighting course, which you can check by following the link in the description. Reverse key lighting, or as it's sometimes called, upstage lighting or narrow lighting, is a really simple technique originated in theater productions and often used in cinema productions as well. The technique which helps lighting look more three-dimensional and cinematic by utilizing a fairly specific key light placement, which you'll be familiar with after watching this tutorial. Before we begin, of course, this is not the only way to set up cinematic lighting. This is an examination of a technique that works, but there are other techniques. Alright, to cut this story short, not all lighting directions create the equal illusion of depth. As a rule of thumb, the key light set up the camera side creates arguably less impressive shadows and just less shadows in general, thus creating an image that is slightly more flat than the image produced by the key light placed slightly behind or at an acute angle to the subject, which helps to emphasize depth and dimension, and accentuate both 3D forms that you have carefully modeled and material properties that you spent so much time setting up. Of course, every technique should be used with intention and should be motivated, but if you are looking for a versatile lighting setup which just looks cinematic, then here it is. We have prepared a blend file that would ease you into this technique, so if you want, follow along with me. We have a simple scene here, a skull stuck in the mud, the main or the key light, because this technique applies to the key light, and a bunch of cameras. You can see three of them here. They have their own collection called camera. Currently, and for the most part of the video, we'll be looking through this one. The viewport should be set to cycles real-time rendering, and obviously we have cycles in the render settings as well, with the experimental feature set turned on to enable sweet displacement effect, because our ground shader uses true displacement. As a bit of a fill light, I'm using the environment color. The strength can be tweaked here. I'm keeping it fairly subdued, just to fill in the shadows ever so slightly, hence the strength of just one. The hero light of this setup will be the light underscore key underscore 01A. It can be found in its own collection. It is a good old area light, nothing special about it. If we have a look at the light settings, a neutral white light with a power set to 100 watts, not too dim, not too powerful, everything else basically is set to their default values, including the default spread of the beam shape. I thought I would mention how I'm gonna be positioning the lights throughout the video. Basically, shift plus right click to drop the three cursors somewhere, and then with the light being active, I press dot on the keyboard to set the pivot point to 3D cursor then. It can also be found in this menu. Finally, I'm gonna press R to rotate the light, and then X, Y, or Z to give it an axis of rotation. Like this. And now we can easily target this light by orbiting it around our 3D cursor. Once again, R, and then Z, for example, to constrain it to the Z axis. I think it is really easy and satisfying to move lights in this way. So with this information out of the way, we can jump into setting our key light. So what is so cool about reverse key lighting? You see, when the light is on the camera side, like here for example, it almost lines up perfectly with the camera direction, it leaves very little shadows. We can say that the frontal lighting tends to be flat, although it has its own uses. Then what happens if I slide the light slightly off to the side? The lighting becomes slightly more three-dimensional, right? Or off to other side, for that matter. Basically, the more angle we give to our key light, the more three-dimensional it becomes, as a rule of thumb. Now we can say that it is a side light in relationship to our camera and the skull. And as a side light, it starts producing some definition in the shadows. Here, here, and here. We can already see some nice shadows being drawn. Let's keep rotating the light until it crosses the line where it's almost behind the subject. If we keep doing that, look what happens. Look at these reflections popping up suddenly. Like, it is the same material, but now we can see beautiful reflections on the skull as well as on the ground, and like, there are shadows everywhere out of a sudden. Now, if we draw the line of action like this, we'll notice that the key light is no longer on the camera side, like we began with. Its position has been reversed, and it's now standing on the background side instead. And that's why it's called reverse key light. We can see the reflection now because the rays emitted by this light bounce off the ground and can actually reach the camera. In addition to that, all the shadows now fall in the camera direction as well. We basically shoot into shadows. I usually picture it this way when I think of reverse key lighting. Shooting into shadows. You can place the light wherever you want now, directly opposite the camera or slightly off to one side. And maybe we can push it further back, like that. The cool thing about this light setup is that only like, I don't know, 10 to 20% of the surface is lit, and everything else is shadows. A huge amount of surface, approximately 80%, is in shadows, illuminated only by the environment fill. And because we film into shadows, we can see the transition from light to dark now. And this transition, the one that I'm marking with the arrows here, is what makes it look three-dimensional. Let me zoom in a little bit to show how this type of lighting helps to flesh out the 3D shapes. Okay, here we go. It just looks 3D. Let's compare it to a more frontal light direction. Yeah, can you see that? There is still some volume picked up by that light, but mostly the definition is gone. The colors now got an extra pop, but the volume is gone. Let's bring the light back to the backside, and I bet you can tell how the 3D quality made a comeback. We can play with the exact position of the key light to amplify or decrease this effect depending on your intention, I guess, but there is no doubt it's a more dramatic look now. The same applies not only to the main object, to the skull in this case, but to whatever is illuminated by that light. The mud, the ground, the bricks on the ground, the details in the mud that got lots of transitions from light to dark. That is the type of the moody look that you can definitely expect from this setup. One of the cool things that you can do with the upstage lighting is to make it sort of wrappy by increasing its size. A nice large and soft light, when placed like that, kind of wraps around the models for a really nice effect. After the size has been increased, the power should be compensated like that. I think 3 times stronger will make it up for the exposure loss. I really love using a soft key light in the upstage mode. I think it looks really appealing and just brings out all the best qualities of the shaders, except the color perhaps, as it mostly brings out the shape. Okay, one more advantage of reverse key lighting I wanted to mention is that it helps to establish a nice hierarchy of values between the foreground and the background layers. The surfaces facing the camera don't receive any exposure from our main lamp, so they remain dark. So you get that classical separation of a darker foreground and lighter background. Again, if we were shoving light from the camera direction, it would contaminate those foreground objects, effectively ruining, or let's say, complicating the tonal values hierarchy. I think that could be one more important aspect of reverse key lighting as a technique, but I think that is just lovely. I'm fanboying or fangirling about that light setup, but it's just too good when you need that kind of depth, for free, as a bonus to shadows and reflections that also sort themselves nicely when the light is conducted from this angle. It just goes very nicely from dark to lighter, to even lighter, so on and so forth. And at the same time, like we have mentioned, we get all the benefits of nice reflections and deep shadows. Let me disable the overlays, as it's a bit distracting. I think we have discussed the main pros of reverse key lighting and how to set it up really easily, so feel free to pause this video and play around with it in Blender, but I actually recommend watching it to the end, because there's still one thing left to discuss that is kind of crucial to get most out of this lighting style. Another question worth mentioning, does this technique apply to the soft light only? Not at all. The light can be softer or harder. The only thing that matters when we go for upstage lighting is the light direction, and this is it. It can be a harsh desert sunlight situation, and still it will look arguably less flat with the key lights, the sun in this case, put behind at an angle. The exact angle is up to you, obviously. It's an artistic matter. Yet it's a really versatile technique, which I'm sure you'll fall in love with, if not already. Oh, yeah, you can do a fun experiment. Watch your favorite movie and try to recognize this lighting style in some shots. I bet you'll find quite a few. So yeah, it can be hard, it can be soft, it can be a mixture of both, as long as you sorted out the direction. Once the light is shining from here to there, from the background direction all the way to the camera, it will most likely just work. Now it's important to mention that if we have more than one shot, so technically, for example, if we have three cameras like we do here, and some of these cameras crossing the line of action, then the reverse key light setup would have to be adjusted for each new camera. That is, if you wanted to maintain this look throughout the film. You can switch between the cameras by selecting one and going control numpad 0 for this camera. This will make it an active one. Just like this. Alternatively, the cameras can be switched from the scene menu. As a quick reminder, we have three of them. Let us inspect the second one. Yeah, as we can see, because the camera switched sides, the key light is no longer reversed. On the contrary, now it is kind of frontal, or at least it shines from the camera side, let's put it like that. Now the third definition of this lighting technique would come in handy. I mean, that's narrow lighting, which means the same as upstage and reverse key lighting. We call it narrow or short because the light should hit the narrow side of the actor's face, not the broad side like we have it here. If the skull is an actor, never mind. Now the light falls squarely on the broad side, the one that is closer to the camera. And guess what? As a result, the subject may appear broader to the viewer, at least that is a stereotype that unironically refers to the foreshortening effect of the short light, which is partially true, not that it matters much. But anyway, we want to see the short side illuminated, right? What we do is dead simple. I'm just gonna drop the 3D cursor here again, and with our light selected, R to rotate, Z to constrain the rotation to the Z axis. So yeah, if you want to maintain the reverse key lighting look, then you would have to update the key light placement in every new shot. It will look fine, most likely, even in montage. Well, technically it's nonsense that the key light is jumping around, yet it should be okay. Now let me quickly adjust the fill light in the environment settings, because I feel that it's a little bit too strong for my taste. It kind of negates some of the benefits of the deep shadows we've got. That would be a shame. So yeah, the formula is really simple. The light jumps back to the back of the scene in every new shot to hit the short side of whatever we are filming. The shadows fall off in our direction very nicely. Indeed, the backlighting picks up all the beautiful edges everywhere. Everyone is happy. Everyone is sipping coffee. Easy stuff. There is a caveat to reverse key lighting. It is not always clear where the backside is, especially in the shots that don't have a lot of depth and no room to squeeze that light behind the subject. Like this shot in the camera number 3. So it's a tricky one to set the reverse key lighting up. It is not clear where the shorter side of the face or skull is, but still camera is not perfectly top down, there is an angle to it, and so it's possible to draw the action line and put the light on the opposite side, let reflection be your guide. In other words, if the camera is on the side A, the key light should be on the side B. That brings us to the end of the video. To sum it up, we have taken a look at how to improve the cinematic qualities of lighting using reverse key lighting technique. It goes without saying that direction matters a lot when it comes to lighting, and some directions are better at creating an illusion of depth and roundedness. Of course, it goes without saying that no single technique is a silver bullet and it should be motivated to work best, and so on and so forth. And there are scenes and shots that call for a completely different approach. But I hope that you'll have a lot of fun integrating this technique into your projects. As usual, don't hesitate to share your images, results, videos with us. It is always appreciated. Oh, a short snippet before we go. Try it for fun. I call it dynamic reverse key. Select the lights and the camera. And in a moment, I will roll it all around our 3D cursor. Watch this. R, Z, and let's go! Whoa! The light that is always in direct opposition to the camera. I think it is pretty neat. Thank you for watching this video. If you want to learn more, much more, in fact, about upstage lighting as a part of so-called framework, then I recommend watching Wandering DP channel. In my opinion, that's one of the best, if not the best, and definitely most clear and straight to the point sources on that subject. And it's totally applicable to 3D, before you asked. Thank you so much for watching, that was Gleb Alexandrov for CreativeShrimp.com. If you liked this tutorial, feel free to follow the link in the description and check out our full lighting course called Cinematic Lighting in Blender. It is an extensive Blender lighting course for 3D artists who want to take their lighting skills to the next level and make cinematic, moody, expressive lighting. Drink more coffee and we will change the world of computer graphics.